Welcome, welcome, one and all. Welcome to Night Fright. I'm your host, Brent Holland. Get the coffee going, get the tea going, get a beverage of your choice going, kick your legs up in the air. Get excited, folks. John Barbour is joining us tonight. John is, and I'm going to read his bio very quickly, a Canadian high school dropout, as most Canadians are. No, I'm just kidding. And he's the godfather of reality TV. Having created the first successful reality show, Real People, he also has produced and directed the definitive biography of D.A. Jim Garrison. Now, Jim Garrison, as most of you older folks with no fans of the show will know, Jim Garrison was the D.A. from New Orleans Parish that went after a fellow by the name of Clay Shaw. Now, I'm going to reference a movie right now, but we're not going to be talking about the movie too much tonight. The movie is JFK, and that's the one by Oliver Stone, of course, and that tells the story of Jim Garrison. But our guest tonight is the only man whom Garrison told his story in the Garrison tapes and recently did a live webcast from the University of Las Vegas featuring three of the very best panelists ever assembled. And I can attest to that because I met all three of them personally, folks, when I was down in Dallas on November 22nd for the 50th anniversary. And those guests are, and we're going to be talking about that tonight, Jim Mars, of course, he's a legend, Joan Mellon, and Dick Russell. Fans of this show will know Dick Russell's been on the show, Jim's been on the show, and I've yet to get Joan on the show, but I'll get her. Dick Russell, folks, for those of you that are unaware, is the author that works with Jesse Ventura. I had Jesse on the show, as fans of this show will know, several months ago. And we talked about Dick's great research work and how Jesse essentially relies on him to do all the research and then Jesse assembles the books afterwards. Continuing along, it's an amazing story. We're going to get into this Garrison thing tonight for sure and a lot of JFK. John was the first person in America to review films on the news, and for 10 years was a controversial film critic of L.A. Magazine. Now, you ready for this, folks? It's not often we have folks like this on. You know that. He's won 5 Emmys. 5. Not 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, no. 4 is not enough. 5 Emmys. 4 for news and 1 for entertainment. The only person in the business to have done so. And prior to that was a successful stand-up comic opening for Robert Goulet, Dionne Warwick, and Bobby Darin. He also did 2 comedy albums. One was called It's Tough to Be White, with liner notes by Dick Gregory. And when Sinatra took over as host of The Tonight Show one night, John was his first choice as guest. His wife is a former band leader with Earl Fatha Hines, and his son is currently co-executive producer and writer on CSI Las Vegas. A lot of this and more is on his amazing website, www.johnbarbersworld.com. John, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us tonight, my friend.
Oh, Brent, I'm delighted, and thanks for having me. You make me sound more interesting than I am.
Oh, come on, don't be silly. This is great, and a fellow Canadian, too, grew up in Toronto. But we won't hold that against you just because you may be a Leafs fan. And the Maple Leafs, folks, is the Toronto hockey team, by the way.
Well, I was a Maple Leaf junkie, as a matter of fact, Brent, when I was a kid. And I played hooky so much from school. I used to go over to a reformatory on Kingston Road in Victoria Park, St. John's Reformatory, and play with the kids there because they had 2 outdoor rinks. So, and I would get on a streetcar on Saturday night, and for 50 cents I'd end up at Maple Leaf Gardens, standing room only. I never missed a game. I was a real, real hockey junkie. And I wanted to be a hockey player, except that my family was so dysfunctional, long before being dysfunctional was popular.
Was popular, yeah.
So I dropped out of school at 15 and then fled to the United States. So my dreams as a hockey player ended. But when I became fairly successful myself and an actor named Bo Swedson, you might remember.
Sure.
Oh, we started the celebrity hockey team in Los Angeles, which still happens to be going strong. I'm no longer a Leafs fan, fortunately, because they break your heart all every year.
No kidding.
I am now a Kings fan, and I notice you've been rooting for the Canadiens, and I must tell you,
yes, sir.
It's a real shock that the New York Rangers are drumming.
I agree. They just rolled over the Canadiens this week, folks, and I think the Canadiens have been outcoached. I think that's the big difference between the two teams. I just don't think the Habs, the Habitants, as they were called, are just up to the task. John, let's go down that rabbit hole. First question I have for you. Are you ready for this? Get your parachute on.
Okay.
What in the world got you involved in the JFK assassination?
Well, it was an accident. And I
Did
must
Did you lose
say,
a bet?
Huh?
Did
no.
you lose a bet? No.
No, it was just an accident, you know. And I've always felt that the very best things in life happen by accident, and all the worst things in life are well planned. Like the Vietnam War was well planned, the Iraq War was well planned, Afghanistan was well planned, the U.S. economy was well planned, but it was just an accident that we found out what the United States was doing to its citizens when Snowden defected from NSA and went to Europe and let us know what the government was doing to us. That was an accident. Well, it was an accident. It's funny, one of my very closest friends and my mentor when I was starting as a stand-up comic, believe it or not, was Red Fox. And this was long before Red became Sanford and Sanford and Son. As a matter of fact, Sanford was his real name. His real name was John Sanford. And his character's name, Fred, in the show was named after his older brother who died. He loved his older brother. Anyway, he was my mentor, and he had a line in his act that I loved. And he said, "Heroes ain't born, they're cornered." Well, I don't consider myself a hero, but I was the original host of the AM show in Los Angeles in 1970, which is where I won my first Emmy. And I got that job, again, just by accident. I had been a stand-up comic all that time, and ABC wanted to start a morning news information show, so they were auditioning everybody to do the show, and somebody called me and said, "Why don't you go and audition?" And the reason that I was knowledgeable about news, not that I was interested in the news for news sake, Brent, it's because I used news to write a lot of the jokes that I did in my act. So anyway, I happened to beat out a few hundred people who were auditioning for the show and ended up as the host. We started out 0.03 in the rating and ended up in 4 or 5 months with a 5 or a 6 rating, which was comparable to the Today Show with only a staff of 4 people.
Wow.
In any event, when I got the show, it was just after Jim Garrison had lost the Clay Shaw trial. He lost it in 1969, but he arrested Clay Shaw in 1967. And being a street kid, you know, I sort of doubted what the government was telling us, because the government and the media were telling us that Jim Garrison was an egomaniac, that he was an absolute nut, and that he had nothing at all, and this was just grandstanding, he wanted to be governor of Louisiana or whatever. And I thought to myself, Brent, you know, if the government is so sure that Garrison has nothing, why don't they get out of his way and let him get into a courtroom and fall on his face? But they did everything they could to disrupt that trial and to prevent him from getting Clay Shaw into a court of law. Anyway, so he lost the case in 1969. But the interesting thing, he wasn't really so much after the conviction for the conspiracy. He was after the conviction for perjury. And very few people know this. He won that case. He had 80 witnesses that saw Clay Shaw with David Ferry and Lee Harvey Oswald numerous times. So he was thrilled that he won that, because, you know, when the government tries to entrap somebody, what they try to do is they try to get them on perjury so they can make a deal. Well, he got them on perjury, but the federal government stepped in and stopped the prosecution. So
they were throwing they were throwing monkey wrenches into his investigation as well, as brick walls and everything.
We found out recently and over the years that his office was infiltrated by over a half a dozen CIA agents and assets anyway.
That's right.
Newspaper people who worked for the CIA, some of them very prominent. In any event, I was fascinated by him because I remember on a newscast when he first arrested Clayshaw, he said very passionately, he said, "We've solved this case, and there will be convictions." And you can look at that clip, and you know that that man is telling the truth. Anyway, he lost, so I didn't pay any attention to it. But one day, I'm in a bookstore, and I see this book called Heritage of Stone, and it said Jim Garrison. So I thought, I wonder if this is the same Jim Garrison. So I picked up the book, and it was the same Jim Garrison. I bought it on the spot. I read it that night, and I was staggered by the information imparted to me as a reader from the information he had gathered at the trial. For example, the Zapruder film. Time Life refused to give him the Zapruder film to show at the trial. He had to take that to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court ordered Time Life to turn over the film. And then a doctor named Zink, who came to testify, said that he was prevented by uniformed generals and admirals from helping perform an autopsy on the president. I mean, all this astonishing information. I was up all night reading it. So the next day I thought, well, I'm going to give him a call.
Can I just stop you there for a second?
Sure,
I've got to explain to the younger folks some of these connections we've just mentioned. David Ferry, folks, was working for Carlos Marcello, who was the godfather of New Orleans, and he was first suspected as being a pilot that may have, forgive the pun, ferried the assassins of JFK out of Dallas that day. That's where he kind of comes into the picture right away. That's enough for you for now, just to give you a background. This is not a nice guy. He was a CIA op. He was doing all kinds of black ops for the CIA during the standoff with Cuba, and he had mafia connections, etc., etc. Many people say that he was integral in the assassination, and we'll get to that soon. Now, the other thing I wanted to mention to the younger folks, too, is the Zapruder film. That is that very famous film, and I'm going to make a reference to the JFK movie again, when Kev Costner goes back into the left, back into the left. It is the most watched home movie ever, and that's the main film that you've seen on the JFK assassination. Now, Mr. Zapruder, that same day, was offered $50,000 by Life magazine, and Time Life magazine bought that film and held on to it and wouldn't release the film, even though there was a subpoena by Jim Garrison, the DA, trying to get that as evidence to prove a conspiracy. Now I'm going to go back to John. Thank you for that, John. But if I don't do these little connections, and I get hell for them, by the way, from people that know who these folks are, we lose the younger folks, and I think it's integral to bring the younger folks along and keep them engaged and involved in this assassination.
Well, Brent, you have to do those verbal footnotes.
There you go.
you step in any time and clarify them all. In any event, I called New Orleans. I got the phone number for the DA's office, and I dialed it directly. And, of course, I expected a female secretary to answer the phone. Instead, it was this bass baritone voice said, "Hello." And I said, "Could I speak to Mr. Garrison, please?" And the voice said, "Speaking." And I said, "Oh, Mr. Garrison, my name is John Barbour, and I host the most successful morning show here in Los Angeles called AMLA. It's live, 90 minutes. And what we do is we have guests on the show. I interview them for about a half an hour, 45 minutes. We open up the phones, and people call in." I said, "Well, last night, I read Heritage of Stone." And he chuckled and he said, "Oh, John, you must be the other one because I only sold two copies." So I said, "Well, Mr. Garrison, I would absolutely love to have you come on the show and talk about your book and the case."
Yeah.
And he said, "John, you'll never get away with it." I said, what do you mean? We won our first Emmy. We're knocking heads with the Today Show. We're just doing terrific. Would you come and do the show? He said, I'd happy to do it, but you'll never get away with it. And I said, look, we're going to book you now. We'll pay your airfare. We'll put you up at a hotel. You'll come on for about 45 minutes, and then we're going to open up the phones. All the calls are unscreened. There's a 10-second delay so that nobody swears. But other than that, you'll be on your own. And I'm telling you.
You still there, John, or have we lost you, my friend? Folks, we're speaking with John Barbour tonight. I think we just lost him. Yep.
Fred?
Yeah, okay, buddy, you're back. That's okay. It's Homeland Security because we're talking about the Kennedy assassination tonight, folks, with
funny.
John Barbour.
So anyway, he said he'd be happy to do it, but I wouldn't get away with it. So we booked him on the show, and a week later I was fired and he was canceled.
Oh, my goodness.
And the interesting thing about Garrison is that Jim Garrison believed the Warren Report when it first came out. He had no reason to doubt it because the government was telling him Lee Harvey Oswald had done it. But he was on the an airplane. He tells his story about Senator Russell Long, who was the dissenting member of the Warren Commission. But in actuality, it wasn't Senator Long.
I know, he
was
hiding.
Hale Boggs.
That's right.
And what Garrison was doing, he was protecting Hale Boggs by saying it was Senator Long.
I'm just going to interrupt you again, John. Folks, the Warren Commission was set up right after the Kennedy assassination in much the same sense that the 9/11 Commission was set up after 9/11 to investigate what had taken place. And their conclusion, they had two conclusions. The first one was scrapped, and perhaps if there's time we'll get into the reason why that was scrapped. The second one came out and said that it was only one lone shooter by the name of Lee Harvey Oswald. All the shots originated from behind Mr. Kennedy, even though a lot of evidence that we'll probably get into tonight shows that there was more than one shooter that shot Mr. Kennedy that day. But that essentially is the Warren Commission. Hale Boggs was on it, as well as Senator Russell. And I'm going to let John go back to it right there. Thank you, my friend, for putting up with this.
Oh, that's all right. The clarification is necessary. In any event, telling us it was Senator Long, he was protecting Hale Boggs, who subsequently disappeared in an airplane crash and they never found his plane. Because he was a dissenting member of the Warren Commission, and the Warren Commission never published his negative conclusions about the Warren Commission's work. So, in any event, Jim became a reluctant hero because he realized when he said Senator Long said that kid could have never fired that old Italian rifle, he says, I'm a hunter, and I could have never fired that rifle, especially at a moving target. And then again, to show you how inept a shot Lee Harvey Oswald was, there was a radical right-wing general named Edwin Walker,
yes,
to be head of the troops in Germany, and he was trying to brainwash all the troops in Germany to join the John Birch Society. President Kennedy heard about it and had the guy fired, and he moved to Dallas, where he became a hero. In any event, Lee Harvey Oswald supposedly took a shot at Edwin Walker and missed. Now, get a hold of this. Edwin Walker was sitting in his back living room on the sofa, much like Bugsy Siegel in Beverly Hills when the Hoods gunned him down over the Flamingo Hotel caper. And Lee Harvey Oswald was in an alley behind the house, not 30 yards away. Half as close as he was when supposedly he shot John Kennedy. And he missed the sitting target. So that's how dreadful a shot Lee Harvey Oswald was. And nobody, but nobody, ever mentions that. So you hear it now for the first time.
Here you go.
So in any event, what he did is he got... There are 26 volumes in the Warren Report, and he got three sets of them. He put one in his house, one in the car, and one in his office, and practically memorized it. And that's when he realized, because Lee Harvey Oswald and Ferry had spent so much time in New Orleans and that was his bailiwick, that he should investigate what it was that they were up to, and that's what led him reluctantly into it. Now, I left that show, and I went to work at Channel 11, which was a Metro Media station, as their resident critic. Tom Brokaw saw me on that station. Tom was at NBC in Los Angeles, and he suggested to the management that they hire this guy that does these terrific film reviews and these commentaries. So they hired me, and I was there for 5 years. And the 5 years that I was there, Brent, not once did I ever have a contract, because if I had signed a contract with them, then NBC would have owned my material. I appeared only every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And two or three times, they prevented me from going on the air. And one story that relates to this business of assassination,
yes, sir,
is about a book called Codename Zorro. I don't know if you've ever heard of the book, but you know one of the co-authors well, because he's a friend of yours, and that's Mark Lane.
Sure.
And Codename Zorro was a book written by Mark Lane and Dick Gregory based on the findings of the House Select Committee on Assassinations.
That's right. Yeah.
The material surrounding the murder by the FBI and the intelligence apparatus of Martin Luther King. And everything in it is a fact. It's not opinion by Mark, and it's not opinion by Dick. It's all provable fact. Anyway, I had written the review, and management, as they always do, they do promos, and they said, tonight John Barbour is going to review a controversial new book called Codename Zorro by Dick Gregory and Mark Lane. And anyway, the news director calls me in after he takes a look at the review. He says, you're not going on the air with this crap.
Huh.
I said, this isn't crap. He says, these guys are conspiracy theorists. I said, none of this. The news director's name was Irwin. I said, Irwin, this has nothing to do with conjecture or opinion. It's all based on fact. I'm just reporting what they're reporting on, and it's in book form. He says, you're not getting on the air with this. So they kicked me out of the station.
Oh, gee.
So I called my lawyer, and I said, I want to sue NBC. And he said, what for? And I said, deprivation of my First Amendment rights, freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. And my lawyer laughed at me. He said, you're nuts. He said, you don't have any freedom of speech for not being able to go on the news and do your review. I said, certainly I do. He said, no, you don't. NBC is the company that has the First Amendment rights because they own the network. If you want freedom of speech, start your own newspaper, start your own network. But when you're an employee, you have no freedom of speech. So I was staggered. Anyway, I don't appear on the 6 o'clock news. And they're flooded with phone calls.
Where is he?
And people are saying, where's John? Where's the review? Where's the review? So Irwin had no recourse except to call me. So I go on at 11 o'clock at night, because it's too late for the 6 o'clock news, and I do the review, and it's a great review, and it's a great story, and the world didn't collapse. You know, the government didn't sink. I went in and the next day, and I said, hey, Washington's still there. The president's still there. But they did that to me three or four times over the stuff that I was doing. But in any event,
what was Irwin's commentary after you came off air? Was he around at that point?
Oh, yes, absolutely. He was the news director. He was there about 18 hours a day.
Wow.
But, you know, they used to resent me a lot because everything I said about what I was going to do on television turned out to be truthful. And as a matter of fact, when I created Real People, I did an interview and a columnist named Maury Gelman for Daily Variety in 1978, and I said, I'm going to change the face of American television with what I called the entertainment of reality. And everybody thought I was nuts and I was an egomaniac, but it changed the face of American television. But sadly, I also told my wife and some friends at the time, this may really be the downfall of American television, because in years to come, You won't have to have any talent whatsoever. You won't have to have the talent to sing or to dance or to write or act or do anything. All you have to do is have the ego to show off, and you'll end up with your own reality show. And sadly, that's what has happened to American television. But in any event, I became the critic. I never met Jim then. I called him during the Vietnam War once in a while. We'd talk about the war when Watergate happened.
Yeah.
I called and talked about Watergate, and there were a few names mentioned at Watergate that were mentioned in Dallas. And then in 1979, when I finally got real people on NBC, and your older audience will remember the show, the hosts were Skip Stevenson and Sarah Purcell and myself, Byron Allen. And in any event, the show was a monster hit. We used to get a 50 share in the Midwest in America. Wow. It was bigger than MASH. It was bigger than I Love Lucy. It was a monster show. As a matter of fact, as a result of the power of that show, I got some legislation passed by the government which helped the country.
Please tell us.
I felt it was my responsibility, if I had the number one show in the country, aside from entertaining people, once in a while I should tell a story that's meaningful. And one of the stories I told was the story of Adam Walsh. You know, might know who John Walsh is,
sure.
Hosts America's Most Wanted.
Yeah, and he lost his little son.
Yeah, well, his son Adam had been kidnapped and decapitated. And he had tried for months and months to get a Missing Children's Act passed with no success. And there were local news stories and CNN carried stories, you know. But they never touched anybody. As news stories never touch anybody. They're incapable of touching anybody. You have to tell people's stories. So in any event, I told John Walsh's story. And within 30 days, the Missing Children's Act was passed.
Muscle
as a
tough.
Result of that story. The Vietnam Memorial that's now in Washington, D.C., everybody takes it for granted that it was there, but nobody wanted it back in 1979 and 1980 because the war was much too controversial. Well, I found a teacher, two teachers in New Mexico who had lost their son in Vietnam. And he and his son used to go hunting on this little mountain all the time. So he decided that he was going to build just a small memorial to his son on this little mountain. And, you know, I am not religious at all, but there's something weirdly metaphysical about certain things that happen in life. And in this instance, this teacher built this memorial to his son. And somehow, with no publicity whatsoever, thousands of people around the country who lost their sons or their husbands journeyed to this little hilltop in New Mexico and wanted a plaque put there with the name or the picture of their son or their husband or their father. And there were hundreds and hundreds of them all over the hilltop. So I told this fellow's story. The next day, I got a call from a senator from Utah. And he said, John, can you get me 50 copies of that story? I said, absolutely. He said, I'm going to send it to every senator's office in the United States because we need...
John Barber's our guest tonight, and he's in Las Vegas, and I got a funny feeling there could be a storm brewing somewhere. Usually when we have internet problems like this via Skype or something along those lines, it is due directly to something with the satellites, and usually what gets in the way of satellites, of course, is storms. I do have a backup phone number, and if he's not back in a few seconds, I will call him on his – there you are. You're back, my friend.
Sorry, because I can't tell when you've gone because the little green light is on the Skype thing here. In any event, the show was so successful, NBC decided to go to the owner of the show. As this often happens, I wasn't the owner. I was just collecting a royalty as the creator of the show. I was the editing. I was the head writer, and I was also the co-host. But anyway, they gave this fellow a show called Speak Up America. And It was going to be hosted by Marjo Gortner, who had been a child evangelist, and then the coach of the American hockey team, the
Miracle team, 1982.
Yeah.
Oh, with Dex. Yeah, I see him too with the big nose and
Herb Brooks.
Yeah, thank you very much. I was going to say Carl
Herb
Malden played him in the movie, but anyways.
Yeah. Herb and I became good friends. In any event, this is 1980, and the owner of the show keeps coming to me and say, John, we need you to help tell us some stories here. And I said, listen, I'm working 20 hours a day on this show. I was writing and editing almost all the hours in their entirety, okay? So I was exhausted. But one day, I pick up the Los Angeles Times, and on page 13, there's a little article that says, the House Select Committee on Assassinations has concluded that four shots, at least, had been fired in Dealey Plaza, and therefore a conspiracy existed. I was thrilled. So I picked up the phone, and I called Jim Garrison. And I said, Mr. Garrison, I said, do you feel vindicated? And he chuckled. He said, John, I feel like a blind man who's gotten a small trophy in a very dark room. Only I know I got it. He had this wonderful sense of humor and this great way of expressing himself. His language was just impeccable. So in any event, I said, I would like to tell your story finally. He said, John, I haven't given an interview in 10 years, and I don't intend to. And I said, wait a minute. I just read this in the L.A. Times. Haven't you been swamped by Huntley and Brinkley and Dan Rather and Walter Cronkite and all these other news giants to now tell your story to them? He said, John, you're the only person who's called me. Now, can you imagine?
Yeah, no, I can't.
The biggest news story in the history of America. It's bigger than George Washington or Abraham Lincoln or anything. It's Jim Garrison and the murder of the President of the United States, who was trying to stop the war machinery from going into Vietnam and was run over and murdered by that war machinery. And nobody wants to talk to Garrison, who's now vindicated by the House Select Committee.
Folks, why that's important is because the House Select Committee on Assassinations, 1978, I believe it came out with its report. There was such a hullabaloo after Watergate in the early 70s that people just didn't believe the government anymore, nor the CIA. And there was an outrage that people knew that something was fishy with both the Kennedy assassination, JFK, and also Martin Luther King. So they put together this commission. And you had mentioned Mark Lane before. Mark Lane's a good friend of mine, folks, and you can find his shows in the archives as well. Petitioned the government to do this investigation, and when they did, both final reports, the final conclusion for both Dr. King and JFK was that it was a probable conspiracy. And they had found four shots, not three, because the Warren Commission had only found three shots. Four shots with President Kennedy. Now, why that's important is because they had said that the possibilities of getting four shots off from one person are minimal. It just couldn't happen. So go ahead.
Let me interrupt you for a second to tell you how insidious the CIA is. The only reason that Mark was successful in trying to petition to get this case open was that in 1977, before he sort of switched sides, Geraldo Rivera showed on late night television the Zapruder film.
Yeah.
So people were up in arms. So when the House Select Committee was founded, they picked the toughest prosecutor in America. His name was Richard Sprague, and he was from Philadelphia, and this was a guy that got hoods sentenced, Teamsters sentenced to prison, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, the CIA called Sprague up and said, you need to come over here for an interview. And Sprague says, no, wait a minute. I don't come over to Arlington for an interview. You come here for an interview, and when you come over here, bring a panel truck full of your notes and your secret documents. Well, the CIA moved immediately to get Richard Sprague removed, and he was replaced by a hack law professor from Columbia who's a CIA asset named Robert Blakey. Robert Blakey concludes that the mafia killed the President of the United States. Now, you and I know, if the mafia killed the President of the United States, there wouldn't be a pizza parlor in America. And if you get Blakey's book about how the mafia did it, the front page is dedicated to the CIA. Now, that is so offensive. Anyway, everybody who is connected with that, and there were a lot of great people working on the House Select, they were literally heartbroken. Tannenbaum, who was a writer, and a lot of really, really great people who did a lot of great investigating, just their hearts were broken because they had been sabotaged again by the Central Intelligence Agency. So in any event, what happens is Jim says to me, I'm going to tell you my story. So I went to New Orleans. I took a camera crew because I wanted to shoot some stories for real people. Mm-hmm. And I sat Jim Garrison down and did over a three and a half hour interview with him in his home, in his library, which must have had 3,000 books on every wall. And he had read them all. And it was the most thrilling, terrifying, inspirational, heartbreaking 3.5 hours I've ever spent in my life with one of the three brightest human beings that I'd ever met. Now, sometimes...
Who were the other two, John?
Buckminster Fuller, who was a scientist who invented the geodesic dome, and my son, Christopher, who, as you said, is a co-executive producer of CSI, one of the head writers. He's brilliant. He's just, these people are just phenomenal. And I am a huge fan of talent. I'm a fan of intelligence. But most of all, I'm a fan of character. Because intelligence and talent are meaningless unless they're accompanied by character. I know a lot of enormously talented people who have no character whatsoever. But Garrison had it all. But sometimes you can be talking to someone and know they're telling the truth by just some offhanded remark. And during the interview, I said to him, I said, Jim, you know, you're a former FBI agent. I said, you're not aligned with any political party. You're a colonel in the Air Force Reserve, and you were at Dachau when that concentration camp was liberated by the Allies, and up on the wall he had a photograph of himself at the fence at Dachau, and underneath he had written, Lest We Ever Forget. I said, whatever made you think you could take on the federal government? And he chuckled, and he said, John, I guess as a kid, I saw one too many Frank Capra movies.
That's funny.
Well, he was talking to me because that was me as a kid, Brent, in Toronto, going to the theater, you know, paying 10 cents to see Jimmy Stewart and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington and Mr. Deeds and all that. That Frank Capra and Jimmy Stewart, these were my idea of Americans. And that shows you how screwed up American cinema made people. I was one of those people who got screwed up. But in any event, we did the story. Now, let me tell you how insidious some of these people are. Now, in 1977, the Church Committee conducted hearings into the Central Intelligence Agency. And they listed, in 1977, 1,000 CIA assets working in mainstream media. At all of the networks, at all the radio stations, at all of the magazines, at all of the newspapers. That was in 1977.
That's explosive. 1,000 assets.
Okay, can you imagine what they have now? Because now what they have to do is they have to fight these fake wars against terrorists. I mean, Gore Vidal expressed it perfectly. He said there are no terrorists. It's like fighting a war against dandruff. I mean, it's just, it's stupid. And America has bought that. But in their hearts, they know the government's full of crap. but they don't do anything. They've been dumbed down so horribly. But in any, so in any event, to show you how insidious some people are, we had so much material with Jim that we had to do a first parter. And the very opening of the very first part is Garrison leaning forward, looking into the camera, full face up, like a 60 minutes face shot. And he said Lee Harvey Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination. As a matter of fact, he didn't fire a shot.
Wow.
Well, I mean, nobody had ever seen that on network television before. So there is a huge audience waiting for the second part of this show on Speak Up America. Now, when doing the interview with Jim, I asked him, I said, how many shooters do you think there were? And Jim said, well, it was a paramilitary operation. It was triangulation. There were probably two shooters in each group, which would make six. He said, and in something this important, they would probably have a phone man. So there are probably three in each, so there's nine. And he said, John, as you know, everything is on a need-to-know basis. So on a need-to-know basis, my guess would be 32. That's just an outside guess. Okay, so anyway, I've edited together the second piece. And I'm sitting at home. I'm having my home rebuilt, and it's costing me a lot of money. I want to build a nice home for my young son and my wife who had sacrificed so much so that I could get started in this business. I was building an expensive home. So I was in debt at the time, and I'm sitting at home watching this, and the story comes on. Now, Marjo Gortner is the guy that is supposedly doing the interview. I just edited him into it. I'm the one who did the actual interview. So when we get to the point where Marjo Gortner is on camera, and he's looking at Jim Garrison, and he says, Mr. Garrison, how many shooters do you think there were? And then there's a cut to Jim Garrison, and Garrison's looking into the camera, and he says, 32. And I screamed, where did that come from? Then the phone rings, and it's the owner of the show. His name is George Slaughter. He's the guy that supposedly got credit for creating Laugh-In, which he never created. It was created by a fellow named Digby Wolfe. He was a guy who unfortunately ended up owning and ruining real people. And he called me up and he said, what do you think? And I screamed at him. I said, what did you do? And he said, Garrison's a nut. I said, you're a nut. What have you done? What have you done? He could sue your ass and sue NBC and own you. This is libel. He said, Garrison is a nut. Well, I hung up the phone and I broke out in tears. I started crying. So I called Garrison immediately and I'm sobbing. I said, Mr. Garrison, I don't know what happened. That's not the way I edited it. And Brent, he said to me, he said, John, I'm used to it. And I said, Mr. Garrison, please, you must sue George Slaughter. You must sue NBC. We can prove malice because libel is deliberate malice. And this was malicious. He went in at midnight with the co-producer on the piece and had it re-edited so you would look like an idiot. And he called me up to tell me what he had done. And I said, please sue. He said, John, I'd be in court all day long if I sued everybody who did this to me. He says, and I don't want you to lose your job. Because my family loves real people. Just send me a half a dozen real people T-shirts, and we'll still be friends. Well, my days with real people were over. I could no longer bear to be around a man as insidious as Slaughter.
Now, John, how does a fellow with integrity like yourself make his way through such a despicable, I was going to say industry, but there's some good people in the industry as well. But when you come across something as blatant as this, how do you deal with that on a personal level?
Well, it's heartbreaking. It's absolutely and totally heartbreaking because here you have a chance to do something for your country.
Yes.
You know, and you have no idea how tough it was for me to become an American.
tell us that, because that's something I wanted to get into as well.
Well, when I came down here when I was 15 or 16, and I had all kinds of odd jobs while I was down here. One of the jobs I had was sorting oranges.
That's right.
On a conveyor belt at Byerly's Orange and Santa Monica Boulevard and Hollywood, and I had the night shift, and the idea was the oranges would come down the conveyor belt, you pick up the rotten ones and throw them in another barrel. And I remember coming home one morning, it was a Sunday morning, it was around 7:30, and I'm walking up La Brea to the boarding house where I'm going to stay, and I see this brand new Cadillac coming down sort of toward me, but it's on the other side of the street. But it pulls over onto my side of the street as I reach the walkway to go in the house. And this voice asked me if I was just coming home from a party. I said, no, I'm just coming home from work. He said, are you hungry? And I said, no, I'm just going to go in and go to bed. He said, would you like to have breakfast? And I said, no, ma'am, I'm just going to go in the house. So I start walking in the house, and I recognized the voice. It was Cary Grant.
Son of a gun.
Yeah, so in any event, in this boarding house, there's a young accountant who was in the boarding house, and he was like a diehard Republican. And I'm not interested in politics, but he's downgrading Canada because it has socialized medicine, and I'm defending Canadian system that I know very, very little about. In any event, after one of these heated arguments, I'm upstairs in my room, and I hear a loud knock at the front door, and the front door opens. There are two uniformed guys, and they ask the landlady if John Barbour is here. And they look very official to me, and then they identified themselves to the landlady as FBI. So I scooted to the back window, jumped out the window right into the arms of another batch of waiting FBI agents.
Oh, my God, John.
Yeah, I was 16 years old, and they were desperate to find these Canadian commies. And the place was surrounded by FBI. So anyway, they found out I wasn't a commie, but they turned me over to the Immigration Service, and I spent. Now, they have what they call a thing called voluntary departure. And
not so voluntary, I'm thinking.
Well, the thing is, if I could get $29 for a bus ticket, I could have gotten on a bus and gone to Toronto. And I called my mother. It was the last time I ever spoke to my mother in Toronto. She was working at Kresge's department store in Toronto, and told her that I'd been arrested and I need $29 to get on the bus to get back to Toronto. She said, you got into this mess and you get out of it. So that was the last time I ever spoke to her. But anyway, I befriended a couple of Mexicans. There were a lot of Mexicans interred there along with me. Very few Europeans, only a couple of Canadians. And I was probably the youngest. So anyway, these were the guys that used to do the laundry or handle the laundry. And we were on like the second or the third floor. And they would gather the laundry from all these guys, put it in this big container and wheel it down to a chute and open up the chute and drop it down. So anyway, they asked me if I would like their help in trying to escape. So we cased the place for a couple of months, and I learned everything about this facility at Terminal Island. And so it was a Wednesday, and they hopped me into this hot, and they call them hoppers. They put me in the hopper, and they fill it with this dirty laundry, leap me over the chute, and drop me down the chute. And I go down three floors, and they said, you'll be okay because you'll land in a bunch of other dirty laundry. And indeed, I did. So I'm down there, and I think, God, I'm free. Thank God I'm free at last. So I go to the front door to open it, and it's locked. It can't be locked. It's impossible that it's locked. It's Wednesday, for God's sake. Then I go to a side door, and it's locked. Then I go to a back door, and it's locked. So for 2 hours, I'm trying to open doors, and I couldn't. So I got tired, and I fell asleep on the laundry. And finally, the guards, after they did the count, they find somebody's missing in the basement sleeping on the laundry. Oh. It's me. So anyway, they hauled me upstairs, and they said, you know what? How could you be so stupid? I said, well, why are all the doors locked? And
it's
they
Wednesday.
Said, it's July 4th, for Christ's sake.
Oh, gee. Oh, gee.
So anyway, they sent me They sent this 16-year-old kid back to Canada in chains. But you know what?
Good Lord.
I was determined to come back because there was no life for me in Canada. You know, my father had deserted when we were just babies, for crying out loud. And my mother was never home. You know, she introduced me to about 22 uncles a year, guys that I would see once and never see again, and most of them were abusive. And
I'm so sorry.
It just wasn't for me. So I decided I was going to come back to the United States and see if I could make something of myself. Maybe they'd have to make me a citizen. Well, I got into another political argument with somebody, and they called the FBI again.
Oh, my gosh.
So anyway, I had some money. I had made some really, really, really good friends. I could tell you an interesting story about Sinatra and the execution of Private Slovak and a fellow named Wexler, who was probably one of the best cinematographers in the country. He did some really, really great, great movies.
John
Wexler's his name.
We're
going
to take a break at 56, at 5:56 your time, for 6 minutes. So what do you say you tell the Sinatra story to take us into that six-minute break? And then when we come back, we'll finish up your story, how you became an American citizen?
Okay, quickly. It's this. I had written a script on speculation. Somebody said, could you write a movie script? I said, I think so. So in 2 weeks, I wrote a script called The Sun Sets in Hell. And it's about five Western characters, and it's all outdoors, so it's very cheap. And anyway, a cinematographer named Haskell Wexler wants to do it. Barry Sullivan wants to direct it. Allied Artists is going to produce it. And here I am living in my car, and I'm having meetings about producing this movie, and I'm really, really excited. So, but anyway, Allied Artists at the last minute decide they don't want to do any more Western. So I get a call from Haskell Wexler, and Haskell Wexler says to me, I have just optioned a book called A Long Day and a Short Life by Albert Maltz. Now, Albert Maltz was one of the blacklisted writers.
Right.
Okay, so I don't know any of this stuff. But I said, why did you buy it? I said, and that guy blacklisted. He said, well, Sinatra just bought The Execution of Private Slovak, and he's going to make it for Columbia. So that'll mean all of Albert Maltz's work, because he's going to do the screenplay, is going to be in demand. He said, "Would you think you could adapt this to a screenplay? It's called A Long Day and a Short Life." So anyway, I adapted in 4 weeks. We have readings at his house. Do you remember an actor named Richard Widmark?
Of course.
Okay,
I love that guy.
Richard, I love that Tommy Udo in Kiss of Death throwing the old lady down the stairs. I'm still living in my car, okay? And I'm having meetings at this house with guys like Richard Widmark, and they're going to make the movie. And there's going to be a ton of money, even for me, for crying out loud, as the writer of this thing. And I'm thrilled beyond belief. Anyway, I get a call from Haskell one day, and he's decided to change his mind. And I said, why? He said, well, evidently, Kennedy got to Sinatra and talked him out of doing The Execution of Private Slovak. Private Slovak was the only American soldier executed
during the
Second World War on orders from Dwight Eisenhower for being a deserter, which was somewhat questionable. So anyway, that went down the tank. So anyway, I get into an argument with somebody, and they call the law again, and they haul me off again. But I now know a few prominent people, and they write some wonderful letters on my behalf. I get a voluntary departure because a friend, a Jewish private investigator who befriended me, gave me $700, said, this is, you fly back, you're not taking the bus back. And I said, I may not ever be able to repay you. He said, just knowing somebody like you is repayment enough, okay? So then I went back. He gave me an attorney who used to be with the Immigration Service, and the attorney says, you know, you'll probably never get back. because you were arrested when you were 15 or 16 on two counts of theft. I said,
Darn, there's the music. John,
I'll finish this.
We'll finish it in 6 minutes, folks. Okay. Don't go anywhere. I'm glued to my seat just like you are. www.nightfrightshow.com. I should have said this more in the past hour, but I'm just glued to the seat and glued to John's stories. This amazing guy. He's done so much. Just click on tonight's guest book DVD cover. That'll take you to a place where you can get his DVD and also take you to a place where you can check out his great website. See you in 6 minutes, folks. Don't go anywhere. I'm Brent Holland from Night Fright. I always laugh, folks, when I hear that little applause there. I always imagine outside the studio window that there's hordes of people there all screaming. And, of course, it's for John Barbour, who's our guest tonight. Folks, if you're just joining us, get a coffee going, get a tea going, get a beverage of your choice going. Kick back, relax. This is your time. And we've got a solid hour left. Brent Holland Show, that's on Skype if you want to ask John some questions. John's had an amazing life. He's just been telling us some stories from when he was a youngster trying to become an American citizen. They threw him out because he was a crazy Canadian communist. Not true, but they did ask him to leave the country a couple of times, sent him home once in chains. Wow, John, what a story. He was also integral, folks, because he interviewed Jim Garrison and made something called the Jim Garrison tapes. Jim Garrison, of course, is portrayed in that wonderful movie by Oliver Stone called JFK. And Oliver uses Jim Garrison's character, Kevin Costner plays him, to guide us through all the lore and the history of the JFK assassination. Now, just before the break, for those of you that weren't around, John was just relating a story to us about when he worked with Frank Sinatra. John, could we pick it up there, my friend?
Oh, yeah, sure. So, anyway, when they sent me out of the country this time, and it was a voluntary departure, they have a thing with the Immigration Service. In my case, because of my background and having been kicked out before and arrested a couple of times as a kid, you have to get permission from the U.S. consulate in order to just ask the Immigration Department if you can come back in the country. So I couldn't ask the Immigration Department unless I first got permission from the U.S. consulate. So when I was about 15 years of age, myself and another guy, his name was Mel, we stole an overcoat at some dance, a high school dance, and then we went down to a drugstore and broke in the drugstore and filled up the pockets of the overcoat with a bunch of merchandise and got caught counting our spoils on the curb in Kingston Road. So anyway, I was given probation for a couple of years or whatever it was. So in any event, when you have been charged with two felonies prior to the age of 16, you cannot come back into the United States, and I've been charged with two. So in any event, I thought what I'd do is I'd track down, see if I could track down my old friend Mel and try to figure out something. Well, Mel, it turned out, had been grew up to be an authentic American Vietnam War hero. Wow. Decorated. Came back to Toronto, pictures taken, front page, and 2 years later was sentenced to 20 years in Sudbury for bank robbery. So I tracked him down, and I took the train to Sudbury. And I met him after all those years, and I told him I feel like an absolute jerk because I'm not sure what I'm asking him, but did he recall the night and everything like that? So he says to me, John, let me write out that I did it. And I said, no, you didn't do it. We did it together. He said, well, whatever you want me to say, just write the story out in your own words. So he wrote it out, gave it to me. So I kept going into the law libraries at the University of Toronto and reading everything about immigration law. Mm-hmm. And then a thought occurred to me. Maybe it wasn't two separate crimes, but it was two separate incidents in the commission of one crime to steal the overcoat so we could have some place to stash the goods. So anyway, I wrote up my presentation, and Spadina Avenue is where the U.S. consulate was in Toronto. I don't even know if it's still there now.
Not on Spadina, but it's down near the City Hall. Sorry. By the way, folks, Sudbury, he just mentioned Sudbury. That's where I started this show, as you all know. I had moved from Montreal to Sudbury for 3.5 years. And
how wonderful.
Yeah, I stayed there for 3.5 years, and it was a beautiful city.
Oh,
got lakes everywhere, every 10 feet.
Yes, how interesting is that? In any event, when I go in, the U.S. Consul General is a woman in probably her early 50s. She reads all the stuff, and I'm standing. I'm so nervous. I can't sit. She keeps asking me to sit, and I tell her I can't. I'm just too nervous. She asked me why I want to go to the United States. And I said to her, you know, your country is the only country in the world that is made up of citizens from every country in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yours is the only country that was designed on a blueprint, the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. All other countries sort of were an outgrowth of whatever, but your country was planned. I said, but that's not what I'm interested in. I said, you know what my life is like here. The life I have here is my reality. But the life I had going to all the movies and watching Frank Capra and Jimmy Stewart, that was my dream. And I can't live without my dream. Your country is my dream. I don't want to live this reality. I have to live that dream. So she just stared at me. And she said, permission granted.
Wow.
And I started to bawl. I mean, I didn't know why. I just started crying. She said, but hold it a minute. That doesn't mean they're going to say yes. It just means I've given you permission to ask them. So anyway, my lawyer hears this and gets the paperwork, and he calls me. He said, John, nobody's ever done this before. He says, that's brilliant. He says, the Immigration Service is going to let you back in the country. And he said, you know, I know judges and I know lawyers, but nobody could have done this but you. And I said, well, it was just so obvious. He said, John, the only reason you got in the country is because you're a talker. So anyway, in 1977, I finally got my citizenship papers, and they were presented to me by Senator John Tenney at a dinner. So anyway, I'm going to drag you back to the Garrison tapes.
We got to finish the Sinatra story too.
Oh, well, there's another part to the Sinatra story, because it extends a long way. Because I hadn't met Sinatra at the time that he had optioned the execution of Private Slovak. I didn't meet him till years later when I was doing the revival of Laugh-In as one of the performer writers. But in any event, to drag you back to Jim Garrison. Well, no, let me tell you how I met Sinatra.
Okay.
When I was the film critic for Los Angeles Magazine and also NBC News in Los Angeles, I got a call in 1979 from George Slaughter, who eventually became the owner of Real People, asking me if he could borrow some of my lines from my film reviews as jokes in a revival of Laugh-In, that they were doing a revival of Laugh-In, and they had four shows, and they had some new performers like Robin Williams and Waylon Jennings and Madam and a few other really good performers. And it was Robin's first big break, and could he have, he said he would pay me for the material. And I said, well, I got a better idea, George. I said, you know what, have a critic at large on Laugh-In. And I'll write my own material. You know, it's only like 30 seconds or 45 seconds. You pay me minimum as a performer and a minimum as a writer. He said, what a great idea. So it turned out for those four specials, myself and George and Digby Wolf and another lady, we wrote these four-hour specials, these revivals. Anyway, one of the guests happened to be Sinatra. And they did Laugh-In on an empty stage. Everything was laugh track.
Mm-hmm.
There was never an audience. And so during rehearsals or run-throughs or whatever, I would always sit in the back of this empty stage up near the ceiling. Sinatra comes out with two or three people, his entourage, and George hands him the material, and he would look at it and throw it away. I mean, he was very tough sometimes and very thoughtless sometimes. And anyway, came across something he liked. He spoke it out loud. Liked it. Okay. So they tape it. And he goes through some more batches of stuff. He does this a half a dozen times, and each one he picks is something that I had written.
Wow.
So he said, who wrote this? Well, George didn't say anything, you know, because George wanted to take credit for everything. But Digby Wolf, who was this drunken Australian, brilliant writer, he says, that kid's sitting in the back up there. And he looks up there, and Sinatra, hey, kid, did you write this? I said, yes, sir. He says, come here, kid. So he calls me downstairs. He says, this is funny stuff. And I said, thanks very much. He said, we're going to talk afterwards. Okay, so we finish shooting. Afterwards, when we talk, he says, you know, I do a lot of very special events, and I need a lot of special material, and sometimes I have to write angry letters to the editors. He said, would you write that stuff for me? I said, I'd be happy to. So he gives me some assignments, and one of them ends up in Kitty Kelly's book, My Way, her unauthorized biography of Sinatra.
That's fantastic.
So in any event, he sends me these checks for $1,000, and I'm not cashing them. I'm putting them on the wall. I don't need the money. I just love that, you know.
You just want his autograph.
He says, hey, kid, how come you're not cashing the checks? And I said, who wants to cash them? I'm going to sell these things later for a fortune. They got your name on them. He said, if you don't cash them, kid, you don't get any more assignments. I said, okay, I'll cash them. So I cashed them. So we became really, really good friends at that time. And he subsequently, because he knew Johnny Carson hated
him. Sure.
And when he took over the Tonight Show, one night was the host of the Tonight Show, he had me come on as a special guest. As a matter of fact, if you go to my site, johnbarbersworld.com, and Google the Tonight Show, you'll see the stand-up that I did there. But he enters in to the Garrison story later, which is really, really interesting, believe me. Anyway, so the 50th anniversary, Brent, is last year.
That's right.
Now, 4 or 5 years ago, there were like 50 shows that said Oswald did it alone, and maybe one or two little shows that said maybe there's some question about it. Now, my friend, Tom Brokaw, is doing a special for the Military Channel and NBC about Oswald, and I called him up, and I said, hey, let me do 5 minutes about Garrison. And he said, no. This was my friend. He said, no. So I knew that nobody would tell Jim Garrison's story. And I thought, you know, it would be wonderful if some network would take Oliver Stone's movie, play the movie, and then follow it with my documentary, which is the real Jim Garrison.
Precisely.
And I offered it free to everybody.
Nobody's
and every one of them said no.
It sounds like my book. Anyways, yeah.
Okay, so now here's what happened. I think I read somewhere that Bobby Kennedy Jr. did an interview with Charlie Rose, in which he said to Charlie, this was in Dallas, mm-hmm. at the Weingarten Opera House, that his father did not believe the conclusions of the Warren Report. He said it publicly, but he privately didn't believe it. Anyway, I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put together a panel of three people who are supportive of the Warren Commission, three people who are opposed to it, and I'll see if I get Dan Rather on one side and a couple of other people, and then maybe Joan Mellon and Dick Russell and Jim Morris on the other side, and pay them a nominal fee and have this panel. So the first person I call is Dick Russell. And I go down to see Dick at Moose and Frank's restaurant in Los Angeles. This was in May. And I said, you know, it's coming up in November, and this is what I want to do. I said, do you think Bobby would be a panelist? He said, you probably have to pay him. And I said, well, certainly I would pay him. I wouldn't mind paying him, for crying out loud. He said, let me talk to him. So he calls me back, and he says, Bobby is interested, and he wants to know if you would book James Douglas, who also wrote a book that Oliver Stone plugs all the time about.
That's right, yeah, JFK and the Unspeakable, folks.
And Unspeakable. And
you'll find Jim's show in the archives as well. Sorry to interrupt you,
James. Oh, that's all right. And I said, well, if I can find him, I'll pay him too and have him on. So I called Joan, bless her heart, because mm-hmm. she has written the definitive books, A Farewell to Justice.
That's right,
Jim Garrison. And her new revised book is just amazing. And I called Joan and asked her if she would be on. And she said, John, you fool. I said, what are you talking about? She said, why give the Warren Commission and jerks like Dan Rather the microphone and the camera when they've had them for 50 years? Oh, you don't need those people. You just need people to attack and point out the lies. As a matter of fact, maybe all you need is Bobby. Now, she is not a fan of Bobby's for a number of reasons, but, and I know that Bobby Kennedy has nothing to say or to contribute about the assassination, but I thought the emotional impact of having Bobby Kennedy
Jr., yep.
Junior, come on. Now, my best friend here in Vegas is George Knapp, who is the weekend host of Coast to Coast.
Sure.
I know. Largest audience in late night radio in the United States. He's just a brilliant journalist. So I called up George and I said, would you like to interview Bobby Kennedy Jr.? We're going to screen the documentary. You're going to interview Bobby Kennedy Jr. You'll bring out me, and then we're going to have an audience, and they can ask questions of Bobby and me. And you, he said, I'd be delighted to. I said, how much do you want to do that? He said, I'm not taking a nickel, John. You've been working on this all your life. He said, and I'd be delighted to interview Bobby. It'd be a great chance to talk to him about this. So anyway, I call Dick Russell, and Dick Russell said, well, you have to call his agent. So I call his agent. Agent calls back and said he wants $25,000.
Ouch.
All I have left is $25,000. So I said, you know what? I'll give it to him. So Bobby agrees to do it. So we set a date for December 12th over at UNLV. Mm-hmm. We have 1,200-seat theater. They are doing everything they can help us to do this because it's going to be a history-making event. It's shortly after November 22nd, okay? So Bobby calls up a week and a half beforehand and cancels. He's nervous. He says, I think Garrison's a nut. And I said to Dick Russell, didn't you send him the documentary? He said, I sent it to him 3 months ago. He's afraid to look at it. Uh-huh. I said, well, call him back and tell him to look at it because Garrison is not a nut.
Yeah.
And, you know, if this keeps up, I'm telling you something, Bobby Kennedy Jr. will never be in the sequel of Profiles to Courage, okay? I mean, this is a chance for something history-making. So the liaison between me and Bobby is Dick, more so right. than the agent. Dick calls me up 4 days before the event, said he's back in. Okay. I said, I'll give him the money after the show. I'm not sending him anything now. So we have 1,200 people waiting. We have George Knapp waiting. We're all set. The day before the event, he cancels. Now,
did he give a reason, John?
The reason was this. His speaker's agent talked him out of it. And the reason was this, that he gets $25,000 to speak about the environment. And his agent told him, if you go around talking about this Kennedy shit, I can't book you anymore to talk about the environment. They'll want to hear about the Kennedy shit. And, well, of course, Bobby didn't want to be involved with talking about the Kennedy stuff. Now, get this.
Yes, sir.
In order to further convince him how sincere I was and how important it was that he'd be a part of this, we're back to Frank Sinatra. What happens is that...
This is an incredible circle you've just created, an arc, my friend.
Yeah, wait till you hear this. Anyway... Sinatra, Bing Crosby dies around 1979 playing golf in Spain.
Yeah.
And I said to Francis, I said, Francis, you know what, your friend Bing just died. He said, hey, Kate, I wanted to be Bing when I was a kid, so be careful. I said, but you know what? He was a great entertainer, he was a great movie star, and he was an entertainment force. But the difference between you and Crosby, you're a social force. You're a political force. If it hadn't been for you and the Rat Pack, Kennedy might not have become president of the United States. Do you realize that?
That's a very good point.
What you want to do, Francis, you want to do an Italian roots. Well, he started laughing because you may remember with a huge series on ABC called Roots.
Of course, yeah.
Alex
Haley, yeah.
Yeah, the Alex Haley thing, right?
Yeah. And folks, just to let you know, just Google, it's fantastic. It traces Alex Haley's roots back virtually to Africa.
Yeah,
it's a bit slavery.
Great. So I said to Sinatra, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come to your house in Palm Springs every weekend. I'm going to put you on camera 2 hours every day for as long as it takes. You will never hear my questions on camera. You're going to be looking into the camera. It will be the first visual autobiography that anyone has ever done. And I said, I'm going to get people who like you, people who don't like you. I said, as a matter of fact, when I was 16 and on my way to Las Vegas, I stopped at the Cal Neva Lodge. I was only 16. And the first star I ever saw in this country was, guess who?
Frank Sinatra.
I said, yes, you walked in arm with Sam Giancana.
Mm.
And his eyes popped. He said, are you kidding, kid?
Momo.
Yes. I said, so I'm going to ask you some really tough stuff, though it may not end up in the documentary. But
I just got to tell folks, Momo Giancana, folks, was the, for lack of a better term, the godfather of Chicago.
That's
and many
exactly
people
right.
Think,
and he was called to testify before the House Select
That's
Committee,
right. Yeah.
And they found him with a bullet in the back of the head and six bullets around his lips.
Keep his mouth closed.
He was killed by his best friend, who was forced to do it by the Central Intelligence Agency. This happened to John Rosselli. It happened to a number of people who were called by the House Select Committee.
John, and just then, speculation, any idea who the shooter was for Momo?
No, I probably have a name, but I don't want to mention
it. Okay, that's fine.
But in any event, I said to him, I'm going to find, you've been in the business for 50 years, I'm going to find people, every 5 years they romanced and married to your music, to have them comment about you. I said, we'll get clips, it'll be the best thing ever. He said, kid, that is just phenomenal, how much do you want? I said, listen, I just want to be able to write it and direct it, and, you know, whatever you give me is fine. He said, you want half? I said, no, gosh, no, I don't deserve half. It's your story. I said, just give me 10%. I said, because it's going to make millions. It'll be on 5 nights in a row, 2 hours a night, 10 nights of Sinatra telling these great stories.
Yeah.
He said, write it up, kid. So I wrote it up. His secretary, Dorothy, called me the next day, and he said, John, I can't tell you. Francis is happier than I've ever seen him before because you know how he loves to talk. He loves to talk about himself. He is so happy about this. And I told him, I said, listen, all the tapes will stay in your house in Palm Springs. I won't have a copy of anything. It's all yours. I'll just come down there and do the final editing and writing. Okay, so now what happens is Bill Holden dies in a drunken stupor. Now, what has this got to do with Kennedy? What has this got to do with Sinatra?
And William Holden's a very famous actor, folks.
William Holden, Bridges on the River Kwai, Network, yeah. Golden Boy, really good, solid actor. Sadly, like a lot of them, a really bad alcoholic. Anyway, the newspapers print the fact that he dies of a heart attack. Now, the coroner who conducts the autopsy is Thomas Noguchi. Now, sidebar, Thomas Noguchi is the coroner who performs the autopsy on Bobby Kennedy. And ever since he performed the autopsy, the LAPD, the Central Intelligence Agency in the city of L.A. tried to get him discharged as the coroner of Los Angeles because he said the fatal shot was fired from no more than 2.5 inches from the rear of the left ear because of the extensive powder burns to the scalp and hair. Sirhan was never closer than 6 feet from in front, so it's obvious he was shot and killed from behind. Anyway,
14 bullets, folks, by the way, counted from a gun that
right.
holds eight.
Okay, so get this. While they're trying to get... Okay, anyway, he conducts the autopsy on Bill Holden. And since Bill Holden had excessive blood alcohol level, stumbled, hit his head on a coffee table, and he bled to death.
Oh, good God.
Okay, so Sinatra's in a rage because it's his buddy, and he doesn't want his buddy remembered as this drunken alcoholic who kills himself falling on a glass coffee table. So he moves to have Noguchi removed. So I have a friend named Robert Blair Kaiser, an ex-priest, who wrote the definitive book on Sirhan called RFK Must Die.
That's right.
And Robert is one of these people that was able to get an interview with Sirhan and the lawyers and the psychiatrist. The book is brilliant. Anyway, he gets threatened, and he's forced to leave the country, and he comes to my house and gives me his manuscript and his notes. So I read all of this stuff reluctantly, and there is no doubt that Sirhan did not shoot Robert Kennedy. It's easier to prove that than it is to prove that Oswald didn't shoot Kennedy because it's just Noguchi's autopsy report. So I contact Noguchi and his attorney, and we form a committee to retain Thomas Noguchi as the independent coroner of the County of Los Angeles, and my prime opposition is Frank Sinatra.
Oh, son of a gun.
And he never spoke to me again.
Oh.
So anyway, I tell this story to Bobby Kennedy, and I said, you know, all my life, I said, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, because they're not theories, you know. I'm a storyteller, and the greatest untold story in America, one that's not broadly known, is the story of Jim Garrison, the story of the murder of your father and the murder of John Kennedy.
That's right.
Okay? That's the greatest story ever to be told. It's greater than the Jesus story, for crying out loud, because it affects the world. The world's gone to crap because they murdered this man.
Wholeheartedly agreed, my friend.
Okay, so anyway, he calls back on the last moment and says he's back in. But now it's too late because UNLV is so tired of Bobby Kennedy that they say, screw him, it's out. So then I thought to myself, hold it. I just can't let this go. I have this $25,000 that was earmarked for him. Find me a date in a small theater at the university. Let me come in and screen the documentary. And let me get Dick Russell and Jim Mars and Joan Mellon to come in. I'll pay them to come in, and we'll do something called the last word on the assassination. So that's where the last $25,000 went. Now, here's the interesting and rewarding part about all that. Let me put that on hold a minute.
Okay.
Just a second. Get back to how I made the documentary.
And I will tell folks, www.nightfrightshow.com, click on the DVD cover, the documentary DVD cover, that'll take you right to a place where you can order it online. Sorry, John, please.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah, no, let me finish this little thing. Okay, so what happened is I added the last word on the assassination. We put it up on Amazon. Now, you know, Amazon put it up in March, April sometime. Amazon has 500,000 titles.
Yeah.
When we put the last word on the assassination up, it was like number 212,000. Within 3 weeks, it was like 198.
Wow.
And last week,
yes, sir?
It's in the top 30 of their 100 best-selling documentaries.
Bravo.
And none of it. There's no publicity. There's no... nothing. It's just word of mouth. And I get these wonderful emails from people that I've never even heard of. And if you go up to Amazon, not only will you find the wonderful endorsements from a number of people like Jesse Ventura and Richard Belzer and the rest of it, but if you want to write a review on the documentary, you have to buy it. And so what people do is they buy it, they screen it, and then they contact Amazon again and they write a review. There are 15 unbelievable reviews up there. They're totally unsolicited by me. So it's really doing well. And you know what? In 50 years, there will only be two films around that will mean anything about the assassination, and I exclude JFK because the two films will be the Zapruder film and the Jim Garrison tapes.
There you go.
Okay, so in any event, 1992 rolls around, and I have all this stuff on Garrison, and I have to keep transferring it from videotape because, you know, it can disappear mysteriously sometimes, so I want to preserve it. Mm-hmm. And Oliver Stone announces that he's going to do the movie JFK. So I call his office and ask to speak to him. He won't come to the phone. So I said, well, tell the secretary. I said, tell Oliver, I have 3 hours of the original Jim Garrison. It's the only three-hour interview he ever gave in which he fully explained his case. And the material and documentation he gave me is just absolutely astounding.
What was Oliver's response?
Well, she called back a half hour later. She said, bring the tapes over here. I said, no. You bring Oliver over here, and he can sit down and look at it, and he can executive produce this if he wishes. But Jim has told me, and I'll show you the document, that I must make it and have creative control over how it's made. I never heard from them again, but I got a call 2 days later from Elizabeth Garrison, who is Jim Garrison's daughter.
Yeah.
Now, at the time, Jim was almost on his deathbed. And Elizabeth called me and she said, have you ever heard of a lady named Rose from Oliver Stone's office? I said, no. I said, I don't know anybody at that office. She said, well, we just got a call from this lady, Rose, who identified herself, gave this phone number and said she was from Oliver's office. And she said that Oliver said that it probably wouldn't be in our best interest, Garrison's best interest, to have John Barbour involved in making a documentary about the
problem.
So I said to Liz, I said, what did your father say? And my father said, screw Oliver, help John. He's been trying to tell my story for 22 years since 1970 when he first booked me on the AM show. So I had the complete support of the Garrison family. And
any speculation why Oliver was so...
No, I don't know, but I can only tell you this.
Yeah.
I have tried many times. I tried to have Oliver involved with doing the last word on the assassination.
Yes, sir.
You know, he always mentions James Douglas' book.
And sure.
I'm glad that Oliver made the movie because it brought the subject to everybody's attention.
John, did you know Jim Douglas is James Douglas's book? Did you know James is a Canadian as well?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, from Vancouver. Isn't that funny? Yeah?
That's terrific. Well, in any event, and it's a nice book. It's not a great book, but it's a nice book.
It's a nice book, yeah.
Yeah.
The Bible for me is always going to be Jim Mars's book.
Oh, yeah, Jim's book. And, of course, the guy who started it all was Mark Lane with Russian
Judgment.
There
you go.
When it first, and, you know, people were always critical of Mark Lane, saying, hey, he did it for the money.
No way.
Everybody turned down the publication of Rush to Judgment?
That's right.
He went to England and published it for $1,500 all he got. And it became such a big bestseller, they had to print it in this country. Okay, so.
Mark Lane is one of my heroes, folks.
Well, he deserves to be. And,
absolutely.
You know, the interesting thing about Mark, because I must tell you, and I may have mentioned this to you, he's a brilliant speaker, knowledgeable beyond words. Surprisingly, though, he has no interest in the Bobby Kennedy assassination.
I didn't know that, John.
I tried to question him a number of times. And the reason for this was when he wrote Plausible Denial, I was going to say that in my documentary, he's never been better. He is so charming and informative and funny. He tells a great story about how they trained Jim Garrison to cope with Johnny Carson on The Tonight Show. It's just great, great stuff.
It is.
But in any event, he published Plausible Denial. And I read it, and I called him up, and I said, you know, Mark, this could be the next Inherit the Wind. This is the greatest court drama I've ever read about.
Yes.
And he said, well, thank you. And so maybe your audience doesn't know, but there was an outfit called Spotlight that said that E. Howard Hunt was a major figure in the assassination. He was probably the bag man who delivered the money to the motels and the halfway houses in Dallas. So anyway, Hunt sues, and a trial takes place in Florida. And the jury finds that Spotlight is right, that E. Howard Hunt probably was involved in the assassination.
That's right.
And it never hits the news at all.
Isn't that wild, folks? Mark Lane, you'll find his shows, and I say shows plurally, in the archives. And don't forget, Mark Lane, folks, was in Jonestown the night of the Kool-Aid, too, and he escaped by the skin of his teeth.
Yeah.
And that's there, too. This is an amazing person, folks, and I'm not kidding. He's been there. He worked with Bobby. He worked with Dr. King. I always tease Mark. I always say, Mark, if you were around in Jesus' time, and then I stop and I go, well, wait a second. Matthew, Mark? Anyways, all that to say, folks, is those shows are there, www.nightfrightshow.com. And he took on virtually the CIA, and the final judgment was essentially that the CIA was involved, E. Howard Hunt, with the assassination of John Kennedy.
Absolutely. And so what I did is I optioned the book. I paid $5,000, and I optioned the book, and I said, let's write a play together.
Yeah.
He said, what a great idea. So for about 6 months, we're working on the play, and it's fun. And some personal problems with him and his new young wife got in the way of everything. She became somehow jealous or overly possessive because he was having an immense amount of fun doing this with me. And she sort of resented our time together. It was bizarre, and I hate to say that because Mark might get really upset if he ever hears this. So it just sort of petered out. But if you ever get a chance to read Plausible Denial, believe me, it would make an unbelievable.
And while we're on the subjects of movies and plays and stuff, don't forget, folks, Mark Lane wrote Executive Action, which was primarily the first JFK, if you will, the first type of JFK movie.
Yeah, yes, it was. Burt Lancaster.
That's right.
And
Will Greer.
Will Greer and that great heavy actor.
I know who you mean. He was in The Dirty Dozen, too, and all so many great. Oh, what's his name? I see him.
Oh, my God. He lived across the street.
I didn't know. I was going to say Richard Widmark, but he was that statue.
God, I can't remember. Really?
We'll think of it. We'll think of it after.
Yeah, so we'll think come about to it.
So probably off air, but we'll think of it. Anyways, just Google it, folks. Executive Action.
Anyway, so that's what happened with that. And so, sadly, we never got to make it, but I still have a copy of the play, and I don't know if I ever get around to redoing that, because I was hoping that the Garrison tapes,
yes, sir,
would have been a monumental theatrical hit so that I could have done part two, because Garrison gave me so much material, I wanted to do a part two called The American Media and the Second Assassination of John Kennedy.
Mm.
And if you go to the documentary, or if you go to, if you see The Last Word on the Assassination and you see the documentary, one of the great horror stories that never, ever surfaces is this horror story of how NBC News tried to literally sabotage Jim Garrison's investigation and trial to the point where they committed crimes.
That's right.
Now, I'm going to tell you something really, really interesting, is that there is a thing now. When I was on television, Brent, in the 70s and early 80s, doing all these talk shows, there was a thing called the Fairness Doctrine. So if I had a Republican on for 15 minutes, I had to have a Democrat on the next week.
Oh, I see. Okay.
If I had a Democrat on, if somebody could prove they could get 5% of the vote, then I'd have to have a socialist on. I mean, I even interviewed Nazis because they could prove they could get 5% of the vote.
Ugh.
The thing called the Fairness Doctrine, and the person who destroyed it was Ronald Reagan. And the reason Reagan destroyed it was because of Jim Garrison. And this is how this happened, is that during the trial, the very best witness that Jim had was Perry Raymond Russo.
Right.
He was an accountant.
Mm-hmm.
So he was contacted by this guy, Walter Sheridan, who was a CIA and FBI asset, working undercover as a producer for NBC News. And his assignment was to get Perry Raymond Russo out of Jim Garrison's jurisdiction as far away as possible. So he calls up Perry Raymond Russo and asks him, where would you like to live if you could live anywhere? And Russo says, California, that's the Golden State. Where in California? Well, Los Angeles, the city of angels, city of movie stars. You want to work as an accountant still? Would you work at an insurance company? And Perry says, yeah. $50,000 a year enough? Yeah, that's fine.
In those
he
days.
Said, okay, here's what you're going to do. You're going to meet me in a motel. I'm bringing a camera crew. And you're going to tell me that Clay Shaw is not Clay Bertram. You have never seen any of these people, Shaw and Ferry and Oswald, together, and that it was all a lie. Okay? Set up the date. I'll make the reservations. So Perry, or I mean, Russo says, yeah, okay, I'll meet you there. So Perry only got involved with the assassination again by accident because he happened to be at a house where they were talking about killing John Kennedy, okay? And now that David Ferry was going to be questioned, he didn't want to be dragged in as one of the co-conspirators, so he called Garrison's office and said, hey, I was there. Garrison called them in. They did the interview, and he says, this is what these guys are talking about, but I was only there by accident, which was true. So anyway, after the call from Walter Sheridan, he calls Garrison and says, thanks, Perry, come on into the office. So Perry goes into the office, and you've seen this a million times on cop shows, Serpico and the rest of them. We're going to wire you. So they wire Perry Raymond Russo, and he meets Walter Sheridan and the NBC crew at this designated motel, and everything that Walter Sheridan said on the phone, he says into the wire, and Garrison records it. I have all of that material, okay? Wow. Now, what happens is that Jim Garrison brings a lawsuit against NBC and charges Walter Sheridan personally with a felony. Well, now the world's going to come down on NBC because they really should lose their license over something like this. Walter Sheridan should be in prison. So they make a deal to have all of that squelched and give Jim Garrison a half hour of time at 11:30 at night on NBC. And, of course, Garrison accepts the half hour at 11:30 because he wants to tell the American public his story.
The truth. Mm-hmm.
So a part of that clip is in the documentary, in the whole half hour you can Google on the internet, and Jim is brilliant.
Yeah, he is.
Absolutely brilliant. He even paraphrases Julius Caesar, you trust these noble men? I mean, it was just wonderful stuff. Anyway, the owners of the country, including Ronald Reagan, see this and say, we cannot have people like this on television. And so they scuttle the fairness doctrine. And if the fairness doctrine had not been scuttled, there would be no Fox News, because Fox News has become the right-wing propaganda arm for the fascist government that the CIA is running in this country. Because if there was no, like you had Hannity and you have O'Reilly, you would have to have Keith Olbermann and any other liberals you could find on the same network. But now that there's no fairness doctrine, it's all bullshit all the time. And that's a result of Reagan seeing Garrison on late night television.
Son of a gun. John Barbour, folks, www.nightfrightshow.com. Click on tonight's guest DVD cover. Get the DVD we've been discussing all night long. And it's called The Last Word on the Assassination. Jim Mars is in it. Joan Mellon, who I'm going to try and get on the show shortly, and of course Dick Russell, and these are outstanding folks. I met each one of them at Dallas when I was there, And I'm proud to say I was the only Canadian invited to speak this year at the memorial.
Wonderful. Good for you, Brent.
I was very, very proud. And the reason for that is, I'll tell you, John, I have Ted Sorensen's last interview.
Oh, my, how wonderful.
On video. And I'm going to contact you off air about that because I'm trying to turn it into a full feature documentary. Revelations, my friend. And in my opinion, confirmation. Conspiracy from Ted.
Well, you know, there's absolutely, totally no doubt about it. I mean, to even question it is just absolutely ridiculous. But in any event, the amazing thing about the last word in the assassination, to me,
sir.
Is the documentary itself. You know what? For me, Brent, it's sometimes hard to believe that I even made the documentary. Because, as I said before, I'm not political. I'm truthfully not political at all. I'm apolitical. Mm-hmm. I'm a-religious. You know, just when you're brought up the way I was, you kind of have street smarts.
Gotcha.
Because you have to survive. But every time I see the documentary, even though I made it, I learned something more. And the wonderful thing to me about the documentary is I'm telling a man's story. I'm not telling the story of the assassination.
Exactly.
I'm telling the story of the man who was involved in trying to solve the assassination. And I talked to his family, I talked to his wife, I talked to his children, I talked to his friends. And you're totally caught up in the integrity and the honesty of what this man is trying to do. So when I put together the panel of the three best people I know to talk about it, I thought, you know, how on earth can they follow this film? Anyway, the documentary is screened, and the audience is blown away by it because they learn stuff mm-hmm. they couldn't even believe ever happened or existed before. And then on come Joan Mellon, Jim Mars, Dick Russell, and they make it better. They expand on it. And one, we took a few questions from the audience, and the best question for me came from an 18-year-old boy, a student, who was so shy about asking it, he's standing in the very back of the room in the shadows, and he's finally forced to ask this question. And the question he asks of the panel is, you know, I'm only 18, and I'm probably not very intelligent. He said, but I do believe the Central Intelligence Agency did kill John Kennedy.
We've got a caller, John. Would you mind taking a call from Washington?
Not at all.
This fellow's name is Alan Dale, and the reason why I mention, usually I don't mention his last name, but he's a very good friend of mine, one of my best friends, and he was at the conference as well this year. He was the MC.
Oh,
and go ahead, Alan. Please ask John your question.
Good evening, gentlemen. Great show. Beautiful show. Happy to have the opportunity to listen to Mr. Barbour and to remember a time when some people of integrity still had access to the public airwaves in this country.
That's what I was thinking.
Mr. Barbour, very briefly, with regard to the figures, the prominent figures of consequence from the earliest days of criticism of the official version of the assassination of President Kennedy, I just want to share with you, in case you may not have learned of this particular incident, something extraordinary happened on November 3rd of 2004. And what happened on November 3rd of 2004, I think, is an extraordinary, extraordinary moment where, for the first time in this story, a Washington Post reporter in the company of a military intelligence scholar, a man named Dr. John Newman, was asked by a Washington Post reporter, Jeff Morley, if he would be interested in accompanying Jeff to interview a lady named Jane Roman at Ms. Roman's house in Washington, D.C. And Ms. Roman was an interesting figure. Jeff had learned about she was a senior desk officer in the counterintelligence division, James Angleton, CIA, in 1963, and 6 weeks prior to the assassination, Ms. Roman responded to routine inquiry from the CIA station in Mexico City about a figure who had shown up and picked up by the surveillance programs telephonically, been photographed, we believe, and certainly had been entered into the documentary record through routine surveillance of both the Cuban consulate and the Soviet embassy. So the short version...
Is that the stocky figure that the CIA identified mistakenly as Oswald?
It's certainly true that that stocky figure plays into the complexity of what was going on 6 and 7 weeks prior to the assassination. The man who's done, the most recent extraordinary work on Oswald in Mexico City, his impersonation 7 weeks prior to the assassination, and most importantly, how the CIA responded internally to that impersonation, is a man named Bill Simpich, and he has a book that is available free of charge from the Mary Farrell Foundation. That's maryfarrellfoundation.org, I think, or maybe
.com. Connection on the website as well, folks.
Yes, it's a book called State Secret.
I got to rush you along because you've only got 2 minutes, and I want to get...
So sorry. Short version is this. John Newman knew what to ask Ms. Roman. And what came out of this extraordinary and improbable opportunity was Jeff Morley's recording this conversation. It's a very cordial scene. It's in Ms. Roman's house. John Newman knew what to ask her because he knew what had happened. He knew how to read and how to interpret the internal documents, the CIA, from 1963. So he asks her head on why something seems to be intentionally misleading in terms of her response to routine inquiry from the CIA station about what do we have on this guy, Lee Oswald, that we picked up in the Soviet embassy and Cuban consulate. She responds because she's directed to what she responds with seems to be intentionally misleading. And he says, Dr. Newman says, I'm really asking you to address head on what your take on this is. This many years later, she says, well, I'm signing off on something I know isn't true. Ultimately, he presses her with courtesy. He presses her and he says, I'm really asking, does this indicate to you an operational interest in Oswald 6 weeks prior to the assassination? Her quote is, well, to me, it's indicative of a keen interest in Oswald held very closely on a need-to-know basis.
So that's the CIA knew about Oswald in advance.
6 weeks prior to the assassination, and she's referring to the executives above her, probably in the Special Investigations Group of the Counterintelligence Division of the CIA. Anyway, thanks.
What do you think?
Ellen, is this the same John Newman who wrote the book on Oswald?
It certainly is. Also, JFK in Vietnam, he's an extraordinary disciplined scholar. These guys are extremely cautious, extremely careful. And he became a significant figure in the screenplay, the final screenplay of Oliver Stone's JFK. He rewrote 9 or 10 scenes, which ended up in the film.
30 seconds left.
Ellen, thanks for the call, but let me make this observation. There are literally thousands and thousands of people like yourself and John Newman, not only in America, but around the world, who know so much about the background of the assassination, which I find interesting, and I read a lot of their stuff, but I find it also distracting. And the reason it's distracting, while it's imparting new information, it's not going after the people who murdered them.
Yeah.
It's distracting us from it. We should be naming names of people who were there to murder John Kennedy.
Damn it. You know, sometimes, folks, I have guests on that I wish I had 3 or 4 hours to deal with. John, you're going to have to come back. Alan, thank you for joining me. Kelly Logue, thank you. As always, www.nightfrightshow.com. Click on tonight's guest DVD cover. Get, please get, his documentary, The Last Word on the Assassination, which has Jim Mars, Joan Mellon, and Dick Russell in it. John, thank you so much, my friend.
Thank you so much, Brad.